today I'm particularly interested in finding formulas for the following sum, actually. Let me go ahead and start writing those sums, and you guys can probably help me because let's start with this one. I'm going to introduce some notation here, but hopefully it's for the best, and so that we are more organized. So 1 to the power 0 plus 2 to the power 0 plus 3 to the power 0 and so on, all the way up to n to the power 0. What is this sum equal to? Yes, I think everybody would decidedly agree that each of these summands are 1, each of the terms. And because we have n terms here, that sum is simply equal to n, because we have n of these n terms. There you go. All right, so next, I would like to ask this one, s sub 1 of n. What is this sum equal to? 1 to the power 1, 2 to the power 1, 3 to the power 1, and so on, all the way up to n to the power 1. Nice. Okay, so it seems you guys already know the idea. Yes. So it turns out that this thing is, let's say that this is a guess from us. We are guessing after testing a few values that the answer might be this. Why? Because earlier when we guessed, it seems it satisfies the pattern. So S sub 1 of 1 is just a 1. S sub 1 of 2, 1 plus 2 is a 3. S sub 1 of 3, 1 plus 2 plus 3, that's a 6. S sub 1 of 4, 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 is a 10. And you might say, well, yeah, so that seems like the number 1 here is just 1 times 1 more, 2 over 2. This one seems like 2 times, so whatever is the inside, the argument, 2 times 1 more divided by 2. This one is 3 times 1 more divided by 2. It's kind of common sense that 4 times 5 over 2, that's the case. But how can I be certain that this pattern won't break? How can I be certain that this thing will hold true for all positive integers n? That's right. So what we can do is, if you have a guess, induction is the best, fastest way to prove a statement, right? Only if you have a guess. If you don't have a guess, that's not gonna work. All right, so let's prove this by induction proof. So that's our claim so far, claim, unless we know a good trick to do it, right? So the proof would be the following. So we will check the base case. And obviously we checked the base case already, n equals 1 works. Actually, we did it more than that. We checked n equals 1, 2, 3, all of these works. But really the base case is n equals 4, 1. Does it work? N times, so 1 times 1 plus 1 over 2. Yes, that's indeed 1, it works. Next, we will look at the induction step. So we will assume the statement is true. Statement true for n. What does that means is we are assuming for a moment that this statement is true for n. This is correct. And show that it is also true. Show that it is true for n plus 1 as well, right? So namely, what I really want to show is s sub 1 of n plus 1 is equal to, maybe I should have used k as the let's just use k here. So assume that the statement for a moment holds for k. Let's quickly change these. S sub 1 of k, that's true. And we want to show that it also holds true for k plus 1 as well. For k plus 1, meaning if we were to substitute k plus 1 over there, that would have been k plus 1 times k plus 2 all divided by 2. That's what I want to show. So far, the only thing I know is this and the base case. All right, so what we can do is we can, so because my goal is to calculate this, which technically is, we can write the definition, 1 to the 1 plus 2 to the 1, all the way up to 3 to the 1, k to the 1, and lastly, k plus 1 to the 1. Hey, look at that. I already know the first few terms. The first few terms is just s sub 1 of k plus k k plus 1. But earlier I said that I already know the formula for s sub 1 of k. It is this monster over here. So I might as well just replace it there. Let me go downwards. So that would be just k times k plus 1 all divided by 2 plus k plus 1. You guys agree? And now I can just use my algebraic manipulation tricks. Plus 2k plus 2 all divided by a 2. And that would be equal to k squared plus 3k plus 2 divided by 2. Aha! I can factorize the numerator k plus 1 times k plus 2 all divided by 2, and yes, by induction, we have proven that, because that was our goal. Our goal was to show that whenever it works for k, it must also work for k plus 1, and we actually did it. You guys see that? You might question the validity of induction as a proof technique. You can prove that induction as a proof technique is a valid technique, but that's beyond this class, obviously. But it is a valid technique. And this is arguably one of our best friends. What was the alternative? What if we didn't know such a formula? Like, we didn't check, is that, we could have, the alternative would have been to find out an algebraic trick to do it. And sometimes algebraic tricks are hard to come up with, right? So most of the time, this type of argument, especially for instance, for advanced math, usually seeking a pattern. And then once you make an observation like we did here, we can make it as a claim and then use induction to prove it. This will be your best friend in a sense. Awesome. So having said that, we can, I guess, well, do you guys want to see the trick? Does anyone remember how to find this without using induction, but rather using some algebraic tricks? Anybody remembers? Okay. Yeah, a couple of people have some ideas. Because this is, obviously, we are asking a bunch of sums. Okay, let's go back here. So our goal is to show that, well, our goal is to compute, not show. No longer I have a guess anymore, right? My goal is to focus on this thing, n to the power 1, which is actually, let me put it in summation sign, if you will, for k equals from 1 to n, k to the power 1, right? Or you might just ignore the 1, basically. Yes. So what does that mean? What is one of the best tricks that we use when we do when we manipulate summation signs? Yes, arithmetic series. Usually something, if we can write this sum in a special way, like the k in a different way, usually in summations, one of the best tricks that we always use is telescoping. I don't know if you guys remember telescoping, but telescoping is a great thing. And it turns out this is the trick for this question. Like, it's totally, wow. So, I mean, very surprising to see that, how in the world can I write this in a different way so that it will telescope, for God's sake? How can I manipulate K itself? How, is there another way to write K so that I can use telescoping? Ah! There's an awesome guy in the room. Yes, awesome guy had a very great idea, actually. So let's pursue the idea of awesome guy. Awesome guy said, let's just have a look at this thing here. Minus k squared. What? Where did he see that coming? Look, this was just the first degree, right? The exponent of k here was first degree, and I'm going one level higher. Do you see that? I go to the second degree. So that turns out to be a huge observation. Let's quickly have a look at that. K squared plus 2k plus 1 minus k squared. That's just 2k plus 1. This is promising. The reason I say this is promising is the following. So if you now take the summation of both sides of this expression, I'll take the summation of here, I'll take the summation, and I'll sum them from 1 all the way up to n. Okay, let's do it. Summation k equals from 1 all the way up to n, 2k plus 1 That's equal to, well, apparently the summation, again, of these terms, k equals from 1 to n, that weird difference, k plus 1 square minus k square. Wait a second, I can just expand out the right-hand side. So plug in 1, you get 2 square minus 1 square. Plug in 2, you get 3 square minus 2 square, and so on. You guys agree? Finally, you plug in, n, and you get n plus 1 square minus n square. Here, pretty much all the terms will cancel on the right-hand side, right? So you can see the cancellations. The 2 square will cancel there. The 3 square will cancel far below. And then the n square will cancel with something previously. So what we will be left with on the right-hand side will be n plus 1 square minus 1 square. Actually, let me go ahead and do it in the next row. So here on the left-hand side, so this is equivalent to, on the left-hand side, I can manipulate this summation sign, k equals from 1 to n, plus summation k equals from 1 to n. I'm just splitting there. And on the right-hand side, we establish that we are just left with n plus 1 square minus 1. Aha. Well, in fact, you can, wait. On the, yes. Yes, that would be correct. So on the right-hand side, let me go one step further. N squared plus 2n plus 1 minus 1. So, okay, so right-hand side is really n squared plus 2n. That's correct. On the left-hand side, okay, we have the desired sum that we were looking for. I'm super happy. That's just 2 times s sub 1 of n plus, and this sum of 1s, what is this sum of 1s equal to? Yes, do you guys agree with dotted and all the others? Yes, that's just an n, and that's equal to, on the right hand side, we still have n squared plus 2n. I can just move that n to the right hand side and divide both sides by 2, so that would imply that s sub 1 of n is equal to n squared plus n over 2. Aha, and we did it. We just proved the same claim over again. So do you guys see the difference between the two proofs? So the first proof, we used induction. How were we able to use induction? Because we started with a guess. If you have a guess, how do you make a guess? You seek a pattern. Once you are kind of more or less convinced that the pattern should hold forever, then you might say, okay, so I'm guessing this. Right? And then you try to prove it. And in our case, we did prove it using induction. So that was the end of the first proof. Then we looked at a second proof. What if sometimes we don't have a guess? If you don't have a guess, then you try to find a trick. And the trick is, awesome guy suggested to use this trick over here. This one. You guys see that? That's amazing. To go one dimension higher. I don't know if you guys... this technique is actually turns out to be super cool technique to go one dimension above. Just to give you an idea, do you guys remember Menelaus' theorem from geometry? You guys should remember it, right? So when do we use Menelaus' theorem? To prove what type of statements do we use Menelaus' theorem? Yes, if you want to show 3 points are concurrent on a line, you would use Menelaus' theorem. It would be quite a shocker to see that you can indeed prove Menelaus' theorem by just looking, going on the one dimension further. So the statement of Menelaus' theorem is about 3 points which are collinear on a plane. So it's quite surprising to see that if you have Evan Chan's Euclidean Geometry for Math Olympiads book, it has a very amazing proof of it in page 47. I highly recommend you look at that proof later on when you have time. So in that proof, in order to prove Menelaus, you just go up one dimension to the third dimension, and the proof is direct. You don't have to pretty much do no calculation whatsoever. So yeah, it's pretty good. But this type of arguments are useful. Okay, so let's keep furthering our analysis of these power sums, I would say. So by now we have at least two techniques that we can resort to anytime we need. So how about S sub 2 of n? I know at the beginning some of you guys mentioned it. I forgot to take note of what you guys said earlier. So this one is n squared. Yes. What is this equal to? Ah, you guys are pretty good. So because you guys mostly seem to know the formula, what you can do is if you already know the formula, you can just set this equal as a claim and then use induction again, right? Yes. But suppose that I did not know it. And further, I had no clue about how to further implement this technique, this trick of going the upper dimension, okay? So one thing that I observe is, if you guys already checked, for instance, we just looked at S0 of n, and we found out this was n. And then we looked at S sub 1 of n, and we found out the formula is n squared plus n over 2. Do you see any pattern that I can utilize? If I can, suppose that I don't know what this is. There's a pattern which seems to be emerging, like at least a weak pattern. What is it? Yes, dotted has amazing. Yes, the degree increases by one. So one other way, so I'm yet going to show you a third method. We can make a following claim. We can claim that this is an, because it keeps increasing by one, I would guess that the degree of this one would be something like a cubed. All right, so let's try it. B and so, could it be like that plus D, let's say. All I need, if it is true, is to figure out what is A, B, C, and D, right? Let's just plug in some values for N and solve it for A, B, C, and D. So for instance, why don't we simply plug in N equals 1? This is 0, 1, 2, and 3, for instance. I need at least four equations so that I get four equations, four unknowns, and I can solve it, right? Yeah. The reason I wanted to start with 0 and not 1, 2, 3, 4, because the equations get very messy when I do 1, 2, 3, 4. So you might wonder, how in the world can I plug in 0 when the sequence starts from 1 square? We might as well add a 0 square in the front, right? So we might assume that the sequence in reality starts from 0 square. So I think it's reasonable to do that. All right. So then I start with the following system of equations. So S sub 2 of 0. When you plug in 0, so that's just 0 squared, which is just 0. And when I plug in 0 here, all I will be left with a D. Okay, so D is 0 in this thing. Let's next plug in 1. If I plug in 1, 1 squared, that's it, just, it's just a 1, is equal to plug in 1 on the right-hand side. I get 1 A plus B plus C. D is already 0, I won't even bother it. S sub 3. Oh, sorry, no. S sub 2 of 2. Sorry for that. S sub 2 of 2 is equal to 1 squared plus 2 squared, which is a 5. You guys suggested it earlier. And on the right-hand side, that will be 8a plus 4b plus 2c. And finally, S sub 2 of 3 will be plugging in 3. 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared, 9, 10, 14. And on the right-hand side, we have 27a plus what? How many b's? 9b, yes, thank you. And 3c. That's it. So I already took care of D. All I have now is a system of three equations, three unknowns. It should be pretty solvable. Can you guys, let me give you 2 minutes. Can you solve it for A, B, and C for me, please? Thank you. I really appreciate that. So solve this for A, B, and C, because we already did it for D. D is apparently zero. Well, at least that's the claim. So it seems everybody agrees that A is 1/3. So do you guys confirm, Samuel? Is B, okay. Yeah, it seems people seem to, yes, confirm that B is 1/2. And then this one is 1/6. We already have this zero. And yeah, so we might go back to our original place. Huh? So this one, and that's it. Are we done? 1/3 A, 1/3 n cubed plus 1 half n squared plus 1 sixth n. So is that it? Did we prove that S sub 2 of n is this? Yes, this is just an engineer assumption at this point. Yeah, that's right. So all that is, so this formula so far, we just proved that it holds for 0, 1, 2, 3. That's it. It doesn't mean that it will hold forever. Remember, Euler had some very bold statements about some conjectures that he didn't prove in his lifetime, which seemed to be correct for very small values of n, but for very, very large values of n, it turns out that, yes, it doesn't hold, right? So this is just, yeah, in order to prove it, again, we need to step back and we need to use induction again. So we didn't prove it, but it's easy to prove this using induction, and I'll just leave it to you. So you still need to prove this using induction, or we can use our trick. Remember, we kind of tested the trick once. Why don't we try to implement our trick one more time and see if that trick is what, robust, and that we can generalize that trick probably. So let's go back. So we want this sum here, right? So 1 squared plus 2 squared plus da 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 plus n squared, which is just the summation sign, k equals from 1 to n. Let me just move things up. Okay, k squared. So I need to write this as a telescoping difference, right? So k squared. So how do I do that? Well, I think you guys, just like with the trick that we did earlier, we'll go the one dimension higher. And yes, the difference of cubes, just like Samuel did here. Okay, so let's go ahead and do that. If you check k plus 1 cubed minus k cubed, so that thing will come out as 3k squared plus 3k plus 1. And now I can go ahead and take the summation sign of both sides of this equation, right? So I will take the summation of both sides. Let me do the summation of this one on the left-hand side. So therefore, we will have 3 summation of k squared plus 3 summation of k plus summation of 1, summation of 1 is equal to, on the right-hand side, because the summation starts from k equals 1 to n, on the right-hand side, I can just expand that, just the way I did it earlier. When you expand it out, it will give you differences of cubes, 2 cubed minus 1 cubed plus, so it will keep going like this. Oops, I don't want to see that and that. Okay, so hold on. Okay, so sometimes my machine is just overheating, it seems. Sorry for that. So 3 cubed minus 2 cubed, and so on, right? So we did that earlier. And finally, n plus 1 cubed minus n cubed. And indeed, like we did previously, the 2 cubes will cancel, the n cube will cancel with something previously, the 3 cube with something else. So what we will be left with will be these two terms. You can double check those. But then, so this is implies 3, this is the term that I wanted to calculate, plus 3 times the summation of k starting from 1 to n. We already calculated that. We proved it in two different ways. That was this, plus the summation of ones, that was just an n. And the right-hand side, like we said, is just n plus 1 cubed minus 1 cubed. And now we can move everything to the right-hand side. In fact, I can even expand this thing out. Let me go ahead and do that. Plus 3n squared plus 3n plus 1 minus 1, right? That minus 1. So they really cancel. Now move everything to the right-hand side. And ultimately, the sum of k squared will be equal to 1/3, because eventually I will divide by 3. And on the right-hand side, I will have all of this, n cubed plus 3n squared plus 3n. And then I'll subtract this one, minus n, and I'll subtract this term, minus 3 over 2, n times n plus 1. And you can do the bashing, and you should be able to get exactly what you guys claimed earlier, n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1, all divided by 6. So this is the formula, k equals from 1 to n. So this is the formula for S sub 2 of n. That's pretty neat. And we can keep doing it this way. In fact, let's see if this trick is robust so that I can rely on this trick at all levels, right? It seems it's a good trick that I can want to generalize it, right? And that's exactly what I will do. In fact, a great mathematician did it 304 years ago in 1716. A mathematician, a Swiss mathematician called what? His name starts with a B, not Boomer. What could be that great mathematician whose last name, family name starts with a B? Yes, that's right, Bernoulli. Bernoulli was actually the first guy to figure this trick. Basically going 1 degree higher and mixing things together with telescoping features. So he was the first one to figure this out, and let's go ahead and reconstruct his proof. And then, so that will be something of interest. Obviously, Bernoulli is a last name. This family, the Bernoulli family, has been a very successful family historically. Mathematicians, their uncles, their grandfather, the child, the grandchildren. So all of them are mathematicians in a sense. Very good mathematicians. Okay, so I'll do the following. I want to have a look at this difference basically. S sub k of n plus 1 minus S sub k of n. I want to check this difference. Well, earlier we defined this. So this is 1 to the k plus 2 to the k plus dot 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 plus all the way up to n to the k plus n plus 1 to the k. And from that, I want to subtract. Well, I want to subtract 1 to the k minus 2 to the k minus dot 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 minus n to the k. Well, when you look at it like this, okay, let me write it carefully. It's clear that this difference is equal to what? How many people do we have today? Wow, we have a lot of people here, more than 300 people. That's great. Okay, so what do we do? Yes, the difference is all of these terms will simply cancel out, right? It will just cancel out. What we will be left will be the last term. So let me go ahead and this is one way to calculate this sum, right? Bernoulli thought that was one way to do it. But then suddenly Bernoulli came up with an amazing idea. What was his amazing idea? His amazing idea, pretty much the same trick that we did earlier, was to just shift these minuses by one. So just realign them. This is the spirit of telescoping, actually. That's exactly what he did. Okay, let's recalculate this difference in a different way. So we are calculating the same difference in two different ways. So 2 to the k all the way up to n to the k. So what we will do is we will start from 1 to the k all the way up to n minus 1 to the k. Sorry, everything will be a minus on the second line, right? Because we are subtracting. So this is a minus, that's a minus, minus n to the k. Suddenly he said, wow, look at that. So what I can do, so therefore this whole thing is simply equal to 1 plus 2 to the k minus 1 to the k plus 3 to the k minus 2 to the k. That's exactly the thing, right? So n to the, well, let me just wrap it up. So n plus 1 to the k minus n to the k. Do you guys agree? So it's just the sum of these things. If you guys want, we might as well put it in a summation. Well, okay, so let me just show you how to write this in a summation sign. So in a summation sign, that will just be equal to from I equals from 1 to n, right? I plus 1 to the k minus I to the k. All right, so if you want to see it in summation sign. That's exactly the thing that we did earlier. That's exactly how Bernoulli thought of that. And interestingly, if you indeed do that, let me go ahead. So this difference, you can work it out elsewhere. Let's work it out elsewhere if you want. Let me work it out here. I think you guys would agree that I plus 1 to the kth power, what can I do it? I plus 1 to the k, that would be equivalent to just using the binomial expansion. Yes, that's correct. The binomial theorem, basically. So all I do is just expand, I plus 1, for those of you who don't remember it, so it's x plus y to the nth power, or let's just use k, x plus y to the kth power is just equal to, well, k choose 0, x to the k, plus k choose 1, x to the k minus 1 times y, or y to the 1, and so on, right? So let me just go further. K choose 2, x to the k minus 2 times y squared, and all the way up to k choose k minus 1, x times y to the k minus 1. Last term will be, k choose k, just y to the k. So in this expression, for instance, we can just calculate i plus 1 to the kth power first. Well, if you do I plus 1 to the kth power, so we are just replacing x with an I, so that will still be k choose 0, I to the k, plus k choose 1, I to the k minus 1 times y to the 1, but y is just the 1, so I don't need to do anything there. K choose 2, I to the power k minus 2, and so on, all the way up to k choose k minus 1, I to the k, and finally, k choose k, that's it. And all I will do is I will subtract I from it. When I subtract I from it, I to the k, I should say. I will subtract I to the k from that, right? So it will just cancel the first term. All I will left will be the remaining terms, which is the summation of what? From, let me use a new letter, j equals from 0 to k minus 1, k choose j, I to the power j. Do you guys agree? That's what it is. I mean, if you like writing summation sign in general is nice. It kind of is a better way to think of these things. All right, so I'll just embed this into that sum here. So that will be, going back to our original question. So that I have I equals from 1 to n, and now I have a new summation inside after binomial expansion, j equals from 1, j equals from 0, I think it is. J equals from 0 to k minus 1. Wait, was it j equals? Yeah, j equals from 0 to k minus 1. That thing, which was k choose j, I to the power j. That's it. Now, now what we will do is, so there's this idea of whenever you have a double summation sign like this, there's this very cool idea of counting in two different ways, or in this case, summing in two different ways. Technically, there's a very neat way to switch those summation signs. This is a trick, we do it all the time, especially when you guys take calculus. When you calculate double integration down the road, double integration is useful when you calculate volumes. So if the integration inside is a dx, integration with respect to x first, and then integration with respect to y outside, sometimes it might be better to first integrate with respect to y first and then integrate with respect to x. So therefore, there's a neat way to switch those integration signs. It's kind of similar idea. It's possible to switch the summation signs, but because it's relatively more advanced, I will directly expand out all of these summation signs and we will organize. And this is also a nice way to understand what's going on whenever there's a double summation sign. Okay, you guys are ready? Let's just do it. All right, so I am excited of doing this. 1 plus, okay, so what I will do is I will write the rows in terms of I. The first row will be I equals 1. I will just plug in here I equals 1, and I will expand this thing out. So let's do it. So j will run from 0 to k minus 1. So that I have combinations here, k choose 0, k choose 1, all the way to k choose k minus 1. And the i's are all 1s. All right, so let's just do it. So it is k choose 0. We said that all the i's are 1, so 1 to the 0, plus k choose 1, 1 to the 1, plus k choose 2, 1 squared, plus da da da, plus k choose k minus 1, 1 to the k minus 1. Yes. Do you guys agree? So this is the case where I equals 1. Next, I will do I equals 2. So this is k choose 0, 2 to the 0, plus k choose 1, 2 to the 1, plus k choose 2, 2 squared, plus da da da, k choose k minus 1, 2 to the k minus 1. This is I equals 2. I can do the same thing for I equals 3. K choose 0, 3 to the 0, plus k choose 1, 3 to the 1, plus k choose 2, sorry, k choose 2, 3 squared plus dot dot dot, k choose k minus 1, 3 to the k minus 1. Holy. Okay, and finally, we keep going all the way up to n, I equals n, I'm doing last time, k choose 0, I to the 0 plus k choose 1, I to the 1 plus k choose 2, I squared plus da da da, k choose k minus 1, I to the k minus 1. Now the question is asking us to add all these things, right? So basically it's telling us, hey, first add these, then that row. For instance, we can add each row here. And then finally add all of these rows. And once I have outcomes here, whatever they are, not zero, I will add all these columns and I will find the final answer. So what did Bernoulli figure? Bernoulli figured that if you want to add up all these numbers in a matrix form like this, we might, for instance, if I gave you this matrix of numbers, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, how would you add up all the cells inside this thing? We can first have the row sums. This is a 3, this is a 7, and add these things, that would give us a 10. That's one way to find the sum of all these four numbers. Alternatively, I can first add the columns, that's a 4. This one is a 6, 4 plus 6, and then I can add the row sums. Yes, this is called double counting, counting in two ways, I prefer to call it. So exactly, so that's exactly what Bernoulli figured. Why don't we just add these things first? And then those, find the column sums here, and then add them up. That should give you the same thing, all the way up to here. And that's exactly what he did. So that whole thing, let's go back to blue color. That whole thing is equal. What is the sum of the first column? K choose 0 times 1 to the 0 plus 2 to the 0 plus, oh, sorry, the last row was K. Sorry, I made a mistake here. That was all N, sorry. These were all N. This was the general row. Sorry, these are all Ns. Sorry for that. So N to the 0, N to the 1, N to the 2, that's the last row. So what is the sum of the first column? So that's N to the 0, N to the 1. And because remember, we needed to do the summation all the way to n. Do you guys agree that this is k to 0 times 1 to the 0 plus 2 to the 0 plus 3 to the 0 plus n to the 0? That's just s sub 0 of n, right? That's our definition. And then the next column, this is just k choose 1, s sub 1 of n, because it's 1 to the 1, 2 to the 1, 3 to the 1, all the way up to n to the 1. That's just s sub 1 of n, and so on. So we have the next one, which is k choose 2, s sub 2 of n. Let me just get rid of that. We go all the way up to k choose k minus 1, which is just k, right? S sub k minus 1 of n. And what is this whole thing is equal to? That whole thing is equal to n plus 1 raised to the power k. There you go. That's our formula. Well, what type of a formula is this? It's kind of an interesting formula. For instance, if you want to calculate, let me use a different color. If you want to calculate s sub k minus 1 of n, all you need is, if you already calculated the previous power sums, then you can calculate this one. Why? Because you already have the formula for each of the previous one. You can just move it to the right, left-hand side, and boom, that will give you a formula for this monster over here. For instance, remember I got stuck in this one, s sub 3 of n. I think some of you guys mentioned what it is. So how can I calculate this? In order to calculate this, what should I plug into this formula for k? What should I plug in for k? In that formula, what should I plug in for k so that I can calculate s sub 3 of n? Huh? In this recursive formula, I would call it. Huh? No, not k equals 3. I need to calculate s sub 3 of n, so I shouldn't, so I should rather plug in k equals, yeah, because 4, yes, I should plug in k equals 4, because look, 4 minus 1, our formula is shifty, right? So if you plug in k equals 4 in this formula, that should work. Let's double check. Let's see if we can find the general formula for s sub 3 of n, which you so the sum of cubes, right? So when I plug in 4, I get m plus 1 raised to the fourth power equals 1 plus, well, because I plugged in 4, 4 to 0, s sub 0 of, well, s sub 0 of n, I already know what it is, right? It was just an n, plus 4 choose 1 times s sub 1 of n, which is just n times n plus 1 over 2, plus 4 choose 2 of, well, s sub 2 of n, which we calculated earlier as n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 over 6. And lastly, the term that of our interest. So 4 choose 3 here, plus 4 choose 3, s sub 3 of n. Nice. So let me just now make it slightly smaller. I can now easily calculate this. All I do is just move these things to the left hand side. Everything is known, right? And that will give me the formula for s sub 3 of n. So s sub 3 of n will ultimately be equal to 4 choose 3 is just a 4. I will ultimately divide the whole thing by 4. And what's left is this, n plus 1 to the power 4 minus 1 minus 4 choose 0 is just 1, so minus n minus 4 choose 1 is just a 4. 4 times n times n plus 1 over 2 plus minus 4 choose 2 is just a 6. 6 times 6 is just 8. Well, okay, let me just do it in two steps. N plus 1, 2n plus 1, all divided by 6, and that's it. That's the formula for s sub 3 of n. Do you guys see that? And it turns out this is a very special situation. What do you get for the formula when you, what's the formula that comes out? Yes, s sub 3 of n comes out as, let me try to get rid of this, the chat box over there. There you go. Yes, it comes out as, strangely enough, it comes out as n times n plus 1 over 2 square, or if you will, n square times n plus 1 square, all divided by 4. Interesting enough, because we know that n times n plus 1 over 2 is simply equal to what? That's just s sub 1 of n, right? So that's just s sub 1 of n square. That's a very curious result. Do you think there are some other patterns which we can relate other, like s sub 4 of n or s sub 5 of n? Do they relate to each other? Like in this case, this is the square of this monster over here. That's, yes, okay. There are some really neat stuff going on. So if you guys are interested, just on Google, just search Bernoulli sums. There are some amazing relationships going on. And interestingly, it's kind of very shocking to realize something very interesting. It turns out that if you write out all the formulas, the denominators that we found, they are what's called as Bernoulli numbers. You can check it on the web. If you put the Bernoulli numbers into a matrix form and you calculate, you guys don't know, most of you know, don't know it yet, but if you calculate the inverse of that matrix, you got the Pascal triangle. So that's that's a very, very surprising result. Okay, anyhow, so but this is an idea that you guys can explore later on for those of you who are interested in this stuff. All right, so if that's okay, let's kind of see these ideas in more applications. Okay, so let me write out a new problem. So consider this following sum here. Let's see if we can calculate this thing. 1/3 plus 2 over 3 squared plus 3 over 3 cubed plus 4 over 3 to the 4. This sum over here. How can I calculate this sum? Using the ideas that we kind of developed earlier a little bit. Yes. Yes. This is an, yes, you guys are correct. This is a geometrico-arithmetical series. If you have the intermediate algebra book of AOPS, That's where I got this problem from. I think it turned out to be also a Mandelbrot problem. But interestingly, I'll show you two different ways to do this thing. All right. So if you don't, so this shifting idea was great, right? So before I use this shifting idea, in the past, the way I used to solve this was the following. I think it's a very cool idea. It is the following. Oh, wow, we can even use calculus. That's correct. So that's 1/3 plus. I will just split this 2/3 square into two parts like this. 1/3 square plus 1/3 square. Do you guys see how it's still the same ideas? So the 3/3 cubed, I will write it as 1/3 cubed plus 1/3 cubed plus 1/3 cubed. The idea is so simple, but it is so powerful as well, like, right? It's just like the smile of Mona Lisa. So simple, but so powerful, mesmerizing, makes you fall in love with her. Okay, there you go. And this thing will keep going forever, right? All right, so now we can use the same ideas, right? So we can add this horizontally first, and then once we have the sum of every row, we can add the resulting rows in terms of columns. Let's just do it. So what is the first sum over here? This is a well-known sum. This is just a geometric sum, right? An infinite geometric sum with the common, the common ratio seems to be 1/3. The initial term is 1/3. The common ratio is 1/3. There you go. The second one is the same. The common ratio is still 1/3, so 1/1/3. And the initial term is 1/3 square. The same thing for the other guy. The common ratio is just 1/3. So the denominators will always be the same. 3/4, 1 - 1/1/3, right? And this thing will keep going forever. So this is also an infinite sum. Now, yes, now we can go ahead and add up all these things. Okay, so therefore the desired sum, which we called it as S, therefore S is simply equal to what? I can factor out 1/1 - 1/3. And what's left is the numerators, 1/3 plus 1/3 square plus 1/3 cubed, and so on. That's pretty neat. And what is this? Well, yes, that's correct. 1/2/3. And inside of it is yet another geometric, infinite geometric series, 1 - 1/3, which is again 2/3. So therefore, you have 1/2/3 square, which is just 3/2 square times 1/3, which is equal to, yes, 3/4 indeed. That's a very neat way to solve this problem. So this idea of, what did we do? All we did is to split each term into new rows. Do you guys see that? So that was the second term. The third term here, I split it into 3 pieces and so on. Aren't these ideas beautiful? Like, they are so simple, but at the same time, you feel they are so powerful, right? In fact, most of the mathematics, advanced mathematics, relies on some simple ideas like this. So you, in essence, huh, so the essence of it is really simple. The hard part is to express these in notation. That's why when you just search on Google an article written in math, sometimes you see like gibberish. You have no clue what they are talking about. There are so many symbols and things like that. That's another story. That's why some of you guys will study math as a major in college, in university. So that's how do you express these ideas in notation, right? So there's a certain language that we use. But mathematics is not the language. Some people mistakenly, I feel like they say mathematics is a language. Well, the formal part of mathematics is a language, like the part where you study in college, like that. But really, the ideas, the deep ideas, are all tricks like this. So like this shifting idea, double counting idea, all these things. So this is the power of math, right? So these are the ideas that attract people to math, not the obscure notation that people use. I have a degree major in math, right? College degree in math. I mean, that was painful. Well, it is useful, obviously, if you want to express your ideas into other, to communicate them. But deep down, when you want to understand the concept itself, it's okay. All right, after this, what is how about the trick? Let's use the trick that we just learned a few minutes ago with the Bernoulli people, right? The Bernoulli trick was, okay, let's rewrite our sum. So which was 1/3 plus 2/3² plus 3/3³ plus 4/3⁴ and so on, right? So Bernoulli says, just shift it and then subtract it. In fact, we can really make it much more formal by the following. Because we have this arithmetico-geometric series, and the common ratio of the geometric terms is 1/3, here you can do this amazing idea. You can just multiply the same sum by 1/3. This is the same thing as shifting it. So that would be equal to, after you multiply it by 1/3, that will be 1/3² plus 2/3³ plus 3/3⁴. Do you guys see that? How multiplying it by 1/3 makes it shift? Because if you multiply this first term by 1/3, it will give you this. I'm kind of on purpose aligning it with this second guy. Why? Because they both have the same common denominator. Then I multiply the second guy by 1/3 and I get this, but I make sure I align it with the third guy of the first sum. And the same thing this way. So all I did was to multiply this one by 1/3 and then put the result over here. Do you guys see how we use that, those shifting ideas? So that's powerful. Now we can take the difference. Now we can subtract the expressions. Check what happens. On the left-hand side, we have 1 - 1/3 s. And on the right-hand side, we have, well, that 1/3 remains, plus 2/3² divided by, sorry, subtracting 1/3² from it, we'll just be left with 1/3². Hey, that's nice. 3/3³ minus 2/3³, that's just 1/3³. That's nice. Again, 1/3⁴, that's really, really nice. Because this is not just a geometric sum, right? So this is, on the left-hand side, we have 2/3 of s. And on the right-hand side, we can factor out the 1/3. That's the initial term. 1/3, the common ratio is 1/3. So that's 1/3 times 1/2/3. The 3's cancel. So finally, s again is 3/4. Done. Okay. Yes. Are you guys, if you guys are ready, let's do two things. Let me just generalize this technique first, and then let's do two-step question, and then I'll go to another concept, which is also mentioned as power sums, but it has a different meaning. Unfortunately, the word power sum comes to two meanings. One of the meanings is the one that we just did today. So what you can do is, how about this one? We can just, the generalization, so to generalize, is very easy then. So for instance, if s was simply r plus 2r² plus 3r³ plus so on. In the previous question, r was just 1/3, right? If you want, we can even write this as a summation sign. If you want, this is the summation form of the same idea. K starting from 1 to infinity or 0 to infinity, doesn't matter. So all we did is multiply r by the common ratio. You guys agree? And then just write it, align it carefully. So r times r is just r², just align it underneath there. This one is 2r³. Why? Because all I did was to multiply this by r and just align it accordingly and so on. That's it. Now we subtract them. So on the left-hand side, we have 1 minus r times s. And on the right-hand side, indeed, we have r, the initial one, this one. Then these two will r². These two will be r³, and so on. So finally, s is simply equal to, well, the right-hand side is obviously r times 1/1 - r. So that comes out as r/1 - r². That's pretty good. Okay, so let's solve a relatively more challenging problem if you guys want. So for instance, this one. We can actually derive much more complicated formulas by applying them sophisticated, I mean, repeatedly, actually. And that's what I want to do next. This has obviously some strong relations to finite differences, and which ultimately to calculus, obviously. But okay, we will totally ignore those interpretations. Okay, S, how about this one? What if I want to add these numbers? 1 plus 2 square r plus 3 square r square plus, the coefficients are all the squares of numbers, r cubed plus 5 square r to the 4 and so on. That's what the question is asking. And obviously you can replace r with any number you want. So I'm just solving a general question, right? What is this equal to? Yes, okay, yes. We will just start by shifting it once, multiply it by r, and then just shift it once. So that will be, so multiplying this one by r, so that will be minus r. Then minus, if you want, we can call it minus 1 square r. Okay, then multiply this one by r, minus 2 square r square, minus 3 square r cubed, minus 4 square r to the 4. Okay, sorry, minus forever. Now let's subtract them. On the left-hand side, we have 1 minus r s is equal to, so we have a 1 left here. So these two, when I subtract them, 2 square minus 1 square r, so plus 2 square minus 1 square r, plus 3 square minus 2 square r square, plus 4 square minus 3 square r cubed, plus 5 square minus 4 square, oops, that's a 4, r to the 4 plus da da da. Well, we can rewrite it carefully. 1 plus 2 square minus 1 square is 3r plus 9 minus 4 is a 5 r square plus 16 minus 9 is a 7 r cubed plus 25 minus 16 is a 9 r to the 4 plus da da da. Oh my gosh, that sucks. Our method failed. Look, it is still an arithmetical geometric series. What am I supposed to do now? Ah, of course, we can shift it again. Right, let's do it. So this time I'm multiplying it by r one more time. So we have r times 1 minus r times s. Okay, we start, and then we will subtract it, right? Multiply this by r minus r. Multiply this by r minus 3r squared. Multiply this one by r minus 5r cubed. Minus this one by minus 7r to the 4. Minus dot, dot, dot. And now, when you look at the difference, so we have 1 minus rs minus r times 1 minus rs. So we can factor out 1 minus r. Oops. Oh, okay, sorry. I thought I lost you guys. 1 minus r s, after I factor it out, what's left is 1 minus r, right? On the left-hand side, I have a 1 minus r left. So we have the 1 here, so that will carry. 3r minus r, that's a 2r. 5r squared minus 3r squared, that's 2r squared, plus, hey, that's good now, right? 2r to the 4, we stabilized it. So it's no longer an arithmetical geometric series. It's just a geometric series. These are just constants, right? I can just factor out the two. So on the left-hand side, we have 1 minus r square of s. And on the right-hand side, we have 1 plus 2 times. Actually, I can factor out 2r. 1 plus r square, da-da-dat, da-da-dat. And that's just 1 plus 2r over 1 minus r. We can now further move that 1 minus r squared to the right-hand side. Ultimately, the formula for s is 1 minus r plus 2r is 1 plus r, I think. Yeah. On the numerator, we will have 1 plus r. And on the denominator, we will have 1 minus r cubed. There you go. That's a beauty. Like I said, so there's other ways to do it using some calculus as well, if you want. But yeah, so that was a pretty good deal. So let's go all the way up where we started from, right? So if you go all the way up there somewhere, wow, we did quite a few things. It's a miracle how we were able to get that far. All right, we started by investigating the some formulas for these S sub 0 n, S sub 1 of n. Along the way, we talked about induction as a proof technique. Here we did some examples, and we mentioned that induction is only useful if you have a guess. If you have no guess, induction is not useful. So elsewhere, you need to do a lot of pattern seeking until you have something that you can guess. And then boom, induction is very powerful when you have a guess. Whenever you don't have a guess, then, or for instance, for some reason, if the pattern is too complicated to be guessable, so then you need to resort to some sort of tricks. And the trick that we resorted to, awesome guy suggested we can just do look at that difference on the upper level. So we just, for instance, in order to calculate this k, we realize k the power is first degree. We assume we thought that maybe it is just an upper degree, the result. And that's when we decided to look at this difference on the upper level. And sure, indeed, that held true. Then what we did is we did some engineering induction. I think you guys called it as such. S2 of n, we predicted that it should be something in terms of n cubed. And we kind of guessed the coefficients. Well, we found them actually by solving four equations for unknowns, but then we said that in the end, you still need to use induction if you wanted a good proof, right? Which we did. We tried our this difference thing again on the upper level because our thing was the sum of k squares. We looked at the difference of k cubes here, which worked out beautifully. And that was the time when we said, hey, let's pay our homage, respect to Bernoulli, who came up with this idea, and we reproduced what he did here, right? So that was the first person, like about 300 years ago, more than 300 years ago, who came up with this really beautiful idea. At the time, these were like secrets, right? So it wasn't like in the past. In the past, people, when they had some new techniques, they used to not share it like openly, right? So they used to just communicate it with letters to their friends, asking them questions, but not sharing with them their proofs, because they were like taught to be very important. Like it's like the formula of Coca-Cola. Why would you share it with someone else? Where if you developed a new technique, but obviously today that's quite to the contrary of our profession. Scientific endeavor today is when everyone is rushing, if they find something new, whoever is the first person to publish it gets the credit, right? That's why we have now the opposite incentives. The incentives in the past wasn't like this. But anyhow, so Bernoulli figured that, hey, he basically did these two tricks. That shifting trick, he figured, and then this summing in two different ways. And then finally, he realized that it is possible to express any S sub k minus 1 of n in terms of the previous ones. If you know the previous ones, recursively you can calculate the next one and the next one and the next one. And indeed, we did an example where we did it for k equals 4. We were able to do it, right? For k equals 4, we get a formula for S sub 3 of n. For k equals 5, we get a formula for S sub 4 of n, and so on. And then I reminded you, for those of you interested in this topic, if you want to learn further, just on Wikipedia, for instance, you can either check Wikipedia, or if you are in high school, for instance, you can search for more formal articles about Bernoulli numbers. And okay, so that's good. Then we kind of did some examples about these shifting tricks. First, we didn't use the shifting trick. We realized that it's too painful. Then we realized shifting trick is the best. Multiply it by the common ratio and then shift it, take the difference, it works. We generalized it, it works. And then we even tried it more complicated situation where the coefficients are squares. That's why it took us two steps. If it was cubes, it would have taken us three steps. All right, so that was pretty good deal so far. Next, there is another idea which is also mentioned as power sums. And I want to talk about this. I'm sure you've seen this one as well before. In the remaining time, we have about 25 minutes. I want to briefly talk about this. And the question is directly the following. I will just solve one question. I'll try to, on this example, work out the whole idea. And then later on, you guys can do the same thing on your own. So we have the following cubic polynomial, namely the following: x cubed plus x squared minus 2x. Minus 7. So this cubic polynomial apparently has three solutions, R, S, and T. I don't even know if these solutions are real solutions, but regardless, so these are the roots or the solutions of this equation. And the question is asking for the following. The question is asking for r to the 5 plus s to the 5 plus t to the 5, question mark. So given this cubic polynomial, these roots satisfy that, each of them satisfy it, yes. And then the question is, how do you calculate r to the 5 plus s to the 5 plus t to the 5? Okay, so one bad strategy would be to what? To just calculate r, s, and t separately, first of all, and then what? And then plug them in, take their fifth degrees, probably employing binomial expansion, I guess. And that will be very, very painful, as you can imagine, right? Yes, that would be super annoying. Instead, we can employ this technique that you guys mentioned. Isaac Newton came up with this idea, I believe. Something called Newton sums. All right, so we'll have a look into that. But obviously what matters for us is the idea behind it. So let's try to really grasp the idea behind this whole thing. So let's begin simple. Let's start with r plus s plus t. Some of you guys mentioned Vieta formulas. So from Vieta formulas, what is the sum of the roots here? Let's do it. Yes. You guys agree? Yes, that's correct. So that would be a minus one. How about the sum of squares? Because we are in the business of seeking patterns, right? We are meaning-seeking creatures here, human beings. So r squared plus s squared plus t squared. Okay, yes, that might work. And actually it works. That's a five. That's true. So one way to do it is you guys can just use this. It's almost certain that everybody will try this, right? Except that you need to make some adjustments. You need to subtract 2rs, 2rt, and 2st from this. And indeed, by Vieta formulas, r plus s plus t, earlier we found this is a minus 1 square minus 2 times rs plus rt plus ts. But this is just the sum of the roots taken two at a time. The sum of the roots taken two at a time, the formula would be this number divided by, because this is a monic polynomial, divided by one. So that would be plugging in a minus two there. So that would be a minus two. So we have one minus two times minus two, which is a five. That works. Next, r cubed plus s cubed plus t cubed. Well, I guess we can still use the same thing, right? So we can expand this out. Do you guys agree? And then make a couple of adjustments here. How hard can it be? So let me give you a few minutes to see if you guys can think of this. What would be the adjustments that we need to make? Obviously, because this is a trinomial, it has three terms in it. When you cube it, how many terms will it have in the end? When you expand this monster over here, how many terms will it have? No, I thought it was 27 terms, right? 3 cubed, right? Because if you multiply this expression 3 times with itself, r plus s plus t times r plus s plus t, do you guys agree that, so these are not equal, right? So I need to still make some adjustments, but just for the argument's sake. So only when you multiply just these two, you will already get 9 terms. Why? Because r will be multiplied with those monsters, s will be multiplied with 3 times, and t1 will be multiplied 3 times. And the same thing for, we will do it further. Well, obviously there will be some similar terms. We will bundle them together. Yes, that's a whole other story. Yes, that's right. But this business is very tricky and it will take us a long time. And how about when we check r to the 4 plus s to the 4 plus t to the 4? Ultimately, notice that our goal is r. So this will be very, very, very bashy. So we need to find another way to calculate this r cubed plus s cubed plus t cubed. Any ideas? How in the world can I get this? What would be the trick? that Newton figured. What did Newton see? By the way, if in case you are wondering, Isaac Newton, he came up with his theories and his book. You know how he came up with his theories? This is an interesting story. I recently learned about it. Apparently, at the time in England, when did he live? Like 16th century, maybe? 16th or 17th century, I guess. 17th century, when he was in England, I think he was in either Cambridge or Oxford. Yes! At the time in England, there was a plague, pandemic, and the school got closed and they sent the kids back home. Can you believe that? The kids and the professors, they went back home. Now, Isaac Newton, he went to his village. Obviously, for 18 months when the school was closed, he was just like taking a walk in the prairies, I guess, right? You guys watched my prairie video, right, on YouTube. And one day, as you know, he was just sitting under a tree. So you see, so I think I'm trying to look at the things from the positive side. I know everybody is kind of worried about school not being opening and kind of we are feeling down, we are really missing our friends. But who knows, like it might even create a lot of new inventions because people are stuck at home and there's not too much things you can do at home. How many hours of video games can you play, right? For God's sake, I mean, it's like everything has a limit. So as a result, I think a lot of good stuff can come out of it, right? So pretty good. And maybe some of you guys are also already, some of you guys are already looking into studying more math and so on. So that we can really make a good thing out of this deal. Okay, anyhow, so it turns out the trick that Isaac Newton figured is the following. Wait a second. There's a very easy way to calculate these numbers by just looking at this. Originally, remember, because RST are the roots of this cubic polynomial, they should satisfy it, right? That gave him an idea. Why don't we just plug in RST into this formula? Okay, so we have r cubed plus r squared minus 2r minus 7 equals 0. That should satisfy it. The same thing for s. S cubed plus s squared minus 2s minus 7 equals 0. That's good. And finally, t cubed plus t squared minus 2t minus 7 is equal to 0. Now, Isaac Newton probably thought the same way that Bernoulli thought. Instead of adding them horizontally, we might do just what? Yeah, we can just add them vertically here. Just go ahead and do that, right? And by the way, if you watched my Burnside lemma videos on YouTube, that's exactly how I prove the Burnside lemma, right? So it comes out, it boils down to a bunch of equations all written horizontally. We just add them vertically and boom. This is called counting in two ways. Yes. So when you add these equations, the right-hand side is still zero, but look at what happens on the left-hand side, right? Oh gosh. Okay. So on the left-hand side, r cubed plus s cubed plus t cubed. Hey, that's something that I wanted to find that in the first place. This thing here. That's perfect. Plus, the next one is r squared plus s squared plus t squared, which I already calculated it. It's just a 5. I don't even have to write it here. It's just a 5 plus 5 minus 2 times r plus s plus t. Actually, let me do it in two steps. Otherwise, yeah, you guys, some of you will be lost. So r squared plus s squared plus t squared minus 2 times r plus s plus t minus 3 times 7, all still equal to 0, right? Wait, did I mess up? Oh, you want to study the conics sometime? Hyperbolas? I love hyperbolas. Maybe for in an algebra class sometime later on, we can have a look into those conic sections. All right, let's get back to this thing. Hey, I can, so why don't we call this S3 then? S sub 3. So I can call this one as S sub 2, S sub 1. This is a new notation, which is kind of confusing with the previous one that I introduced, but that's okay. And the question is asking for S sub 5, right? Okay, so apparently 0 is equal to S3 plus S2 minus 2 times, oops, minus 2 times S1 minus 3 times, wait, minus, why don't I just call this 3 as an S0, right? Hey, that's pretty good. And you know what is the good news about that? Because I already calculated S2 and S1, and S0 is just 3, right? It is just r to the 0 plus s to the 0 plus t to the 0, which is always just the number of variables, which is 3 in this case, right? So I can easily calculate S3. But the good news is, and if you do so, what do you get for S3 again? What did you say you get? Okay, so let me just go ahead. And so this is minus S2, which is a 5, plus 2 times S1 was a minus 1. Okay, and then minus 7 times 3. Sorry, plus. The signs change. So minus 5 minus 2 plus 21. That's 14. That's correct. S3 is just 14. Nice. How do I find S4? S4 is the same thing, right? I can just take these equations and multiply the first one by R, the second one by S, the third one by T. Let me do it sideways. Over here, so I would get r to the 4 plus r cubed minus 2 r squared minus 7 r equals 0. Next one, s. Oh gosh. Okay, s to the 4 plus s cubed minus 2 s squared minus 7 s is equal to 0. And finally, t to the 4 plus t cubed minus 2 t squared minus 7 t is equal to 0. And now we add them vertically, we get r to the 4 plus s to the 4 plus t to the 4, which is just s4 plus s3 minus 2 s2 minus 7 s1 is simply equal to 0. Hey, look at that. It's pretty much the same relationship which holds here. In fact, all we did is, if you compare these two equations, let me make it slightly smaller so you guys can compare the two. Do you guys see the whole thing? Compare it with the original given equation. The original equation was this. X cubed plus x squared minus 2x minus 7 is equal to 0. Do you see the relationship? It's exactly the same coefficients, right? Ah, so that's why we just end up calling them Newton's sons. So what we can do is, once we know S3, it's easy to calculate S4 now, right? We just plug it in. So let's go ahead and do that. So S4, I just moved these things onto the left-hand side. So minus S3, which is minus 14, plus 2s2, which was minus 1, and plus 7s1, s2 was 5, s1 was minus 1. Okay, s2 was 5, and s1 was minus 1. There you go. And that is simply equal to minus 14 plus 10 minus 7. And that's just what? Minus 11. And lastly, S5. For S5, by now, I know how to do it. I will just keep the same format. So it will be 0 is equal to S5 plus S4 minus 2 S3 minus 7 S2. And now we can just plug things in. So 0 is equal to S5 plus S4 just came out as minus 11. Minus 2 times S3 came out as minus, 14. Minus 7 times S2 came out as 5, if you remember. That's a 5. And ultimately, that will give us what? S5 is equal to, what is this? Minus 74? Okay. Thank you. Wait, no, plus 74. Wait, yeah. So probably plus. Yeah, I assume it's a plus. And that's it. Now, we can now step back and look at what we did here and what is the significance of this trick, right? So how can we make use of it in the long run, right? So all we say is, if it starts with a bunch of roots of a given polynomial, it is possible to calculate what we call as the power sums of these roots by up to, well, okay, here you go, up to the degree of the up to the degree of the polynomial, you need to use some tricks to calculate it. But anytime you hit the degree, as soon as you hit the degree, our trick begins, right? Do you guys agree? So for instance, if the question says, if you have a question which gives you a quartic polynomial, plus 3x squared minus 7 is equal to 0, and then you are told that it has four roots, RSTU, and the question is asking you to find S sub, S sub 6, which means R to the 6 plus S to the 6 plus T to the 6 plus U to the 6. So what you are supposed to do is, you're supposed to first calculate S1, S2, and S3. Okay, I'm not sure if I'm confusing you guys. Actually, let me just move this a little bit to the side. And then let's discuss it like that. Hold on. So that's, yes. So there you go. Okay, so if the question is asking you to calculate this thing, which is the sixth power, let me write it slightly larger. Okay, so given the fact that RSTU are the roots of this thing, so what you are supposed to do technically is first of all calculate S1, S2, S3 manually using Vieta and some tricks, right? So here you need to use Vieta. But then the good news is starting with S4 all the way up to S5 and S6, now you can use Newton sums, right? And that's exactly, okay, so for this part, you can use Newton sums. And as you get better and better at it, you just realize that, because you will just plug in S4 plus 3S squared minus 7 S0 is equal to 0, right? So I can just move those things to the right-hand side. So that will give you minus 3 S2 plus 7 S0. Do you guys agree? The next one will be minus 3 S3 minus 7. Sorry, plus 7 S1. And finally, minus 3 S4 plus 7 S2. That's it. So all I need is really to calculate S1, S2, S3. Well, actually, yes. Once I have S1, S2, S3 that I calculated separately, I can plug them here to calculate S4 first. Then I can plug them here to calculate S5. Then I already calculate S4 as well. I plug them in to calculate S6. It's very doable, very straightforward. Do you guys agree? Okay, just for those of you who are confused on what we did, so if you're wondering where I got this one from, so remember, Newton sums now says the following. Newton sums. Newton says that just check the degree of the polynomial that you have, whatever is the degree, let's say n. So, and your polynomial is something like this, right? X to the n plus a1 x to the n minus 1 plus a2 x to the n minus 2 and so on. An minus 1 x, and then we have the constant term, right? Let me just close this thing. Okay, there you go. Plus an. So if you have a polynomial like this, and if you are given the roots of your this polynomial are roots are x1, x2, all the way up to xn, the n roots of this thing. So if you want to calculate the power sum, S sub k would be x sub 1 to the k plus x sub 2 to the k plus da 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 plus x sub n to the k. It turns out that the Newton sum says the following. This formula works for, so for the case k is greater than or equal to n, there's a quick way to do it, and it's the following. So all you do is, because you are given this polynomial form, all I do is, so replace this one with 0 is equal to S sub n plus A1. Now you just keep going downward. A2, S sub n minus 2, and so on. All the way up to, well, An S sub 0. An S sub 0. S sub 0 in this case, because we have n roots, is n. All right. That's it. This works only after k is greater than or equal to n. So how about power sums less than n? For those, you need to use Vieta formulas, basically. All right, and that's exactly what we did. When we look back into our examples, what we did is we just calculated S1 and S2 first. S1, we found this number. S2, we found that number. And then we used that Newton sum trick for this one, the third one. For S3, what we did is we realized because R, S, and T are the roots of this polynomial, we just plug them in, and that they should make it equal to zero, right? When you plug in r, because r is a root of that cubic polynomial, that makes it zero. S makes it zero. T makes it zero. And then we came up with the idea of adding them like that. When we add them like that, that gives us this, which is pretty cool because that's what we needed to figure to begin with. That was what we needed. And this sum here is just S2. This sum here is just S1. And this one here is, oh, sorry, not the 7, the 3. The 3 is just the S0. That's it. And we did it again for the fourth powers because it's so easy, right? All I do is just multiply this one by R. That's the proof. This one by S and this one by T. You will come up with these things, which again, you can add up vertically. And boom, you come up with this idea. And that's it. Because you already calculated S1, S2, S3. Now you can also find out what S4 is. And finally, for S5, we write the same thing over again. But now I'm not going to bother multiplying by R, S, and T again. All I did was, because this is our polynomial form, this one, in the polynomial, all you do is, whatever is the power you want to use, in this case, it is S5. So you just keep lowering them by one, right? So S4, S3, and S2 finally. And that's it. I was able to calculate S5 accordingly as well. There's one more idea called symmetric polynomials. So this one is very, very related to this idea. And it is the following, at the expense of maybe confusing a couple of you, but it's for a good reason, okay? It is possible to express these things in the case where we were kind of lucky here because it was a monic polynomial. What if it's not a monic polynomial? What if the leading coefficient is not a one? What if it's a different number? Technically, one thing you can do is you can just divide the whole equation by that number, and that would still work. Alternatively, you can utilize those symmetric polynomials. So for instance, r plus s plus t, that would be the first, that's a sum, which you can write it as sigma 1, for instance. And then, maybe it's not a very good idea to go into that. It's kind of maybe confusing, but that's why if you go to a website like Brilliant, I don't know if you guys are using that website, pretty good website. And I think this problem that I took today was from that website. You just need to log in, create an account there, and then you can, you will see that the formulas presented there are in terms of those symmetric polynomials. But the essence is important, even though, in the essence, the whole trick is the same one that we just did here, which is pretty, pretty good, I guess. All right, so, any questions? Yes, so I gave you a lot of, I think, resources. AOPS has a very good book, Intermediate Algebra book. It's a pretty good. So I already told you about Brilliant. And then if you want on Google, you can search about Bernoulli. But this is a little bit advanced stuff. Okay, so Bernoulli numbers. This is slightly advanced stuff. Or in Google, again, if you search power sums, when you search power sums on Google, it will not give you the Newton formulas. It will rather give you those Bernoulli results, right? So you might have a look into those. Wolfram Alpha is good too, yeah? So I use it quite often as well. So you guys want to check those as well. There's a lot of contest problems related to these subjects of adding, shifting, and things like that. Especially in combinatorics, we use this heavily when we calculate probabilities as well. But yeah, so... I guess that's it. That's all I had to say for today. I think Tuesday you guys will be with Miss Null. All right. So I will see you guys again on Thursday next week, on Thursday around the same time. Thank you so much, guys, for joining. And you guys can sign up to our Momentum YouTube channel as well if you're interested. And you can also check our classes. We are starting a new class next week, which is in terms of difficulty, it will be advanced AME level. It will be on Monday evenings as well. So you guys can, not this coming Monday, but the Monday after that. All right, take care, guys. Bye.